Hello friends, today we will cover the Durkheim's one of the most important works, that is Suicide. So let us start now. Durkheim's study of society is suicide is the paradigmatic example of how a sociologist should connect theory and research. Durkheim's most important reason for studying suicide was to prove the power of new science of sociology. Suicide is generally considered to be one of the most private and personal acts. Durkheim was not concerned with studying why any specific individual committed suicide. That is to be left to the psychologist. Instead, Durkheim was interested in knowing why one group had a higher rate of suicide than another. Psychological and biological factors may explain why a particular individual in a group commits suicide, but Durkheim argued that only social facts could explain why one group had a higher rate of suicide than another. Durkheim proposed two related ways of evaluating suicide rate. One is cross-culturally, spatially, and second one is historically, temporally. In both the cases, the logic or argument is essentially the same. The variation in suicide rate depends on social factors. Social factors, particularly social currents. Durkheim acknowledged that individuals may have reasons for committing the suicide, but these reasons are not real. Durkheim began his work on suicide by testing and rejecting a series of alternate ideas about the causes of suicide. Among these are the individual psychopathology, alcoholism, race, heredity, climate, and imitation. Not all of the Durkheim's arguments are convincing. However, what is important is his method of empirically dismissing what he considered extraneous factors so that he could get to what he thought of as the most important causal variable. For example, Durkheim examined and rejected imitation theory proposed by French social psychologist Gabriel Tardin. According to imitation theory, people commit suicide because they are imitating the actions of others. Durkheim rejected this theory by arguing that if imitations were truly important, we should find that bordering nations should have same suicide rate. But examination of the data of suicides in France and Germany showed that no such relationship existed. Durkheim admitted that some individual suicides may be the result of imitations, but it is such a minor factor that it has no significant effect on the overall suicides rate. Durkheim argued that different groups have different collective sentiment, which produce different social currents. It is these social currents that affect individual decisions about suicide. In other words, the changes in the collective sentiments lead to changes in social current, which in turn lead to changes in suicide rate. Durkheim collected data on suicide from official record 1840 to 1870 and found the following observations. So, took the help of official records. Race, first one is race could not be determining cause of suicide. Rich has high rate of suicide than poor. Rate of change of society is significant when there is change in society as a whole. Each society has its own aptitude for suicide as long as society itself doesn't change drastically. Catholics have lower rate of suicide than Protestants. Married people have lower rate of suicide than unmarried. Women are less prone to suicide than men. War time suicide rate is less than that of peace time. At war time, patriotism emerges. People identify with each other. Otherwise, they become individualistic. The most common deciding factor among all above observations was the degree of solidarity, cohesion in terms of integration and regulations. Durkheim accepted the role of psychological factor, but they have a role of predisposition only. Four types of suicide. Durkheim's theory of suicide is based on two underlying social facts, integration and regulation. Integration refers to the strength of the attachment that we have to society. Regulation refers to the degree of external constraints on people. For Durkheim, the two social currents are continuous variables, and suicide rate goes up when either of these currents is too low or too high. Durkheim is talking about integration and regulation. We therefore have four types of suicide. If integration is high, Durkheim calls that type of suicide altruistic. Low integration results in increase in egoistic suicide. Fatalistic suicide is associated with high regulation, and anomic suicide with low regulation. Now let us see what is egoistic suicide. That means low integration, due to low integration. So high rate of egoistic suicide are found in societies or groups in which the individual is not well integrated into the large social unit. So, because of lack of adequate integration or very low integration, this lack of integration leads to a feeling that the individual is not part of society. But this also means the society is not part of individual. Durkheim believed that the best parts of the human being, our morality, values, sense of purpose, come from society. An integrated society provides us with these things, as well as a general feeling of moral support to get us through the daily small indignities and trivial disappointments. Without this, we are liable to commit suicide at the smallest frustration. We can witness in India now, particularly in urban cities, urban centers, particularly in metros. The lack of social integration produces distinctive social current, and these currents cause differences in suicide rates. For example, Durkheim talked of societal disintegration leading to current of depression and disillusionment. Strongly integrated groups discourage suicide. The protective, enveloping social currents produced by integrated societies prevent the widespread occurrence of egoistic suicide by, among other things, providing people with sense of the broader meaning of their life. Durkheim's statistics showed that suicide rate go up for those who are less religious, unmarried, and therefore less integrated into family, whereas the rates go down in times of national political crises such as wars and revolutions, when social causes and revolutionary or nationalist fervor give people's life greater meaning. He argues that the only thing that all of these have in common is the increased feeling of integration. So now let us see the second kind of suicide, altruistic suicide. Altruistic suicide is more likely to occur when social integration is too strong. The individual is literally forced into committing suicide. Durkheim argued that this is particularly likely in the military, where the degree of integration is so strong that an individual will feel that he or she has disgraced the entire group and by most trivial of failure. Similarly, in modern context, terrorists are clearly committing suicide because they are so tightly integrated into some groups that they feel that it is their duty to do so. Durkheim argues that whereas higher rates of egoistic suicide come from incurable weariness and sad depression, the increased likelihood of altruistic suicide springs from hope, for it depends on the belief in beautiful perspectives beyond this life. When integration is low, people will commit suicide because they have no greater good to sustain them. When integration is high, they commit suicide in the name of the greater good. Now, come to third type of suicide, anomic suicide. It occurs when the regulative power of the societies are disrupted. Such disruptions are likely to leave individuals dissatisfied because there is little control over their passions, which are free to run wild in an insatiable race for gratification. Rates of anomic suicide are likely to rise whether the nature of disruption is positive, for example, economic boom, or negative, an economic depression. Such changes put people in a new situation in which the old norms no longer apply but new ones have yet to develop. Periods of disruption unleash currents of anomie, moods of rootlessness and normlessness, and these currents lead to an increase in the rate of anomic suicide. This is relatively easy to envisage in the case of economic depression. The closing of a factory because of depression may lead to the loss of job, with results that the individual is cut adrift from the regulative effect that both the company and the job may have had. Being cut off from this structure or other, for example, family, religion, and state, can leave an individual highly vulnerable to the effects of currents of anomie. Somewhat more difficult to imagine is the effect of an economic boom. In this case, Durkheim argued that sudden success leads individuals away from the traditional structure in which they are embedded. It may lead individuals to quit their job, move to a new community, perhaps even find a new spouse. All these changes disrupt the regulative effect of extant structure and leave the individual in boom period vulnerable to anomic social current. In such a conditions, people activity is released from regulations and even their dreams are no longer restrained. People in an economic boom seem to have limitless prospects and reality seems valueless by comparison with the dreams of fevered imaginations. The increase in the rates of anomic suicide during periods of deregulation of social life are consistent with Durkheim's view on pernicious effect of individual passions when freed of external constraint. People thus freed will become slaves to their passions and, as a result, in Durkheim's view, commit a wide range of destructive acts, including killing themselves. Now, fourth type of suicide is fatalistic suicide. Fatalistic suicide is more likely to occur when regulation is excessive. Durkheim described those who are more likely to commit fatalistic suicide as persons with future pitilessly blocked and passions violently choked by oppressive discipline. That means hopelessness of no future. The classic example is the slave who takes his own life because of the hopelessness associated with the oppressive regulation of his every action. too much regulation, oppression unleashes currents of melancholy that in turn causes a rise in the rate of fatalistic suicide. Durkheim argued that social currents cause change in the rate of suicide. Individual suicides are affected by these underlying currents of egoism, altruism, anomie, and fatalism. This proved for Durkheim that these currents are more than just the sum of individual, but are sui generis forces. Because they dominate the decisions of individuals. Without this assumption, the study of the suicide rate for any particular society could not be examined. Durkheim concludes his study of suicide with an examination of what reforms could be undertaken to prevent it. Most attempts to prevent suicide have failed because it has been seen as an individual problem. For Durkheim, attempts to directly convince individuals not to commit suicide are futile, since its real causes are in society. Durkheim argued that suicides in a less exaggerated form are good for society. We should not want to stop all economic boom because they lead to economic suicides, or not would we stop valuing individuality because it leads to egoistic suicide. Similarly, altruistic suicide results from our virtuous tendency to sacrifice ourselves for the community. The pursuit of progress . The belief in individual and the spirit of sacrifice all have their place in society and cannot exist without generating some suicide. But Durkheim also argued that modern society has seen a pathological increase in both egoistic and anomic suicide. It is largely due to the abnormal way in which labor is divided that it leads to isolation rather than interdependence. Social regulation and integration are too low, leading to an abnormal rate of anomic and egoistic suicides. Many of the existing institutions for connecting the individual and society have failed, and Durkheim sees little hope of their success. The modern state is too distant from the individual to influence his or her life with enough force and continuity. The church cannot exert its integrating effect without at the same time repressing freedom of thought. Even the family, possibly the most integrative institution. The church cannot exert its integrating effect without at the same time repressing freedom of thought. Even the family, possibly the most integrative institutions in modern society, will fail in this task because it is subject to same corrosive conditions that are increasing suicide. Instead, what Durkheim suggests is the need of a different institution based on occupational group. Thus, Durkheim proposes a social solutions to a social problems. We can analyze all these factors Durkheim has mentioned in modern context, like decreasing influence of family in decision making. So now let us see the critical evaluation. Durkheim's study of suicide proved to be a landmark study, particularly for the development of positive tradition. Reliance on the official record, try to arrive at generalization through which social causes are being explained on the basis of data. This work inspired many to do further study on suicide. This work inspired many to do further study on suicide and other social phenomena like industrial strike, crime, divorce. Thus, it opened new vistas for sociological research. Handy and short, reality is very complex. Durkheim only explained two social forces, integration and regulation. They said internal regulation is also must. Morris, Durkheim totally ignored biological factor and restricted only to the social factors. Max Atkinson, official data lack objectivity. J.V. Douglas. Question. Official record objectivity. Greater integration, lower reporting of suicide. Lower integration, higher reporting of suicide. So, J.V. Douglas, question, official record objectivity. Greater integration, according to him, greater integration, lower reporting of suicide. Lower integration, higher reporting suicide. Durkheim's work, extreme social realism and positivism. Durkheim's study on suicide is an excellent sociological work, but partially incomplete. There is need of interdisciplinary approach, particularly inclusion of psychological and biological evidence to make it more inclusive. See all about that. Thank you very much.